Quai des Polars.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
Yeah, Swedish culture was very Francophile at this time. So in the Swedish court, you would speak French. And the Swedish king would write all his letters to his friends in French. And if you couldn't speak French, you will have to sort of, we borrowed French words and stuck Swedish endings onto them. So in this year, previous to this, Sweden had declared war on Russia for no apparent reason. And it was a devastating war, which Sweden won due to a drastic change in weather during one crucial sea battle, where the Russian fleet was annihilated. But Sweden didn't win anything. The realm was ruined. And the king, who was, as I said, very Francophile, he was terrified that the French Revolution would spread to Sweden. And because he was so Francocentric himself, maybe he kind of overestimated the risk of that. But he wanted to sort of court the middle classes, the craftsmen, as much as he could to make them not instigate the revolution. So he would rob the nobility of their money, and the nobility had him assassinated in the year 1792. So this is the year after that, and the Swedish Dauphin, the crown prince, he was not of age. So there was a 5-year interval when there was a sort of interim government, and they had their own agenda, and the realm was terribly mismanaged. Well, as many other authors, I would guess, who are interested in this historical period of time, there's a very interesting friction between a very unjust society and the ideas of the Enlightenment, which will eventually lead to the slightly better society that we live in today. So Cecil Winge, who is my main protagonist, is sort of he's an Enlightenment character. So he will have very progressive ideas about what society should be, and is perhaps not so satisfied about how it looks at present. And he is also suffering from tuberculosis, so he is dying. And when this body is discovered in my book, this will he wasn't supposed to do anything more. He would sort of tend to his affairs and put his life in order, but he agrees to do this final favor to the police chief. So there's a ticking clock when he has to solve the case before he's dying himself. I used to be a journalist, but I was a lonely child, and I used to read a lot of books. So I always dreamed about it. It's been obvious for me from the earliest age I can remember that being a writer, being a company to somebody who has none, is the best thing you can hope to be. So I always wanted to be that. But it was very scary to sort of finally actually write something, because then you risk proving that you're not very good at it. So I was a journalist for many years, where I could write anyway. And I guess I learned some things about how to do research. So I have no historical background as such. I decided that I would want this book to be as historically correct as possible, and there's a lot of material written about this time, so there's no excuse except laziness not to read it. So I would go around every Swedish secondhand bookstore in Stockholm and just buy everything I could about this period of time, which was quite a lot. And it was very funny. I've never had a reading hobby, and I felt very naive as a reader because I've been reading my whole life, but I've never sort of focused on one subject. And that became very, very stimulating. Once you sort of accumulate knowledge about it, then you'll read a new book and you'll think to yourself, ah, I know the source of that fact, and it is in fact disputed. Stuff like that would be really wonderful. And nowadays there's the luxury of many things are digitalized, so there's a level of historical research is much, much easier now than it was just 20 years ago. It is a very famous period in Swedish history, and this King Gustav III is one of our best remembered kings. So yes, there has been a lot of stuff written about it. Not for some time, though, that I'm aware of. I tried to read as much not to sort of to avoid doing exactly what somebody else had already done before. I tried to read up on a lot of what had already been done, and the main sort of convention of that literature is that the murder of the king in the year 1792 will sort of be incorporated into the plot in some way. So I thought to myself, I'll choose the year after that, which is not so well known, and do something else instead. But then I got a prize from the Swedish Academy of Crime Writers, and when I was checking out who else had got this prize, it turned out that exactly 20 years earlier, the prize for best debut novel had gone to a book, a crime novel set in Stockholm in the year 1793. So I was like, okay, it's impossible to do something original. My main inspiration for this book, and one of my favorite books of all time, is a novel by Umberto Eco called The Name of the Rose, which came out in 1980, which is, of course, I remember reading it when I was quite young, and I thought it was just a wonderful book about serial killings in a medieval monastery, and, you know, what's not to like. And then I reread it many years later, and I had sort of access to a whole different dimension of context when you're... And I couldn't believe that I found that book so just exciting when I was young, because there's so much else in there. There's a whole lesson about sort of the doctrine of the Catholic Church and so forth. So I love that book, and I love that it has so many layers, and they each work. I mean, if you're not interested in the deeper layer, it doesn't get in the way, and I thought that was such a magic thing, trick that he did as an author. Also, there's a graphic novel called From Hell by Alan Moore, which is one of my favorite things ever, about the Jack the Ripper murders in Victorian London. Also researched to the point of insanity. And maybe a final inspiration would be Blood Meridian by Cormac McCarthy, which is a horrible book with just the most beautiful language ever about a band of scalp hunters in the American West who goes insane.